this case, the applicant has the possibility of hooking up into the sewer system, and there is adequate, there is reserve capacity for municipal uses, so that certainly is a backup to be able to hook up to the sewer if this system does fail. Are there any questions on that?
How much reserve capacity is there for municipal use in the sewer system?
I guess I would refer that to the town manager.
I didn't bring that material with me, but back when the Southern Cape Elizabeth facility planning process was completed, an allowance was made essentially doubling the current municipal use that was then in effect, and up to this point, none of that has been used.
And no other project online that is currently contemplated?
The only one is the Public Works garage, and that particular project is not anticipated to increase flow because it's continuation of the same use and just a different amount of space.
Thank you.
Unless there are other questions, continuing on with item 12B, the location design of sink. Well, actually, we did that. Let's go back to 12A, stormwater systems. There was an issue raised by the town engineer that there was an assessment made of increased stormwater flows, which appears to be approximately 5%. Those flows eventually entered the Atlantic Ocean. So there's no question that there's adequate capacity at the outfall point. The question is whether what kind of impacts will be experienced between the property, the community center property, and that outflow at the ocean, and how much 5% will impact that intermediate area. The town engineer has requested additional information be submitted, and the applicant is I guess, requesting that no additional information is needed. I guess going down to 12C, location design of potable water supply. Typically, the board receives a letter from the Portland Water District stating whether or not there is adequate capacity to serve the project. The applicant has requested that letter and will be submitting it, I guess, at a subsequent meeting. 12D, location design of methods of solid waste storage and disposal. Again, it's not anticipated to be an issue for this project. However, there has been no information submitted as to how they plan to dispose of solid waste. The applicant has since discussed with me various alternatives, all of which sound reasonable, and I would expect that information to be submitted on the next set of plans. And those are the only issues that are really highlighted in the completeness part of the review.
Any questions? I just reminded that we're not looking at technical merit. It's a case of completeness. Tim?
Yep. Mr. Chairman, in order to understand whether or not the existing sanitary waste disposal system is adequate, I need some information about the use of the project as it currently is and as it will be proposed to be under this new project.
Mm-hmm. I think it's reasonable to expect at least more detail to the existing. I think the town engineer also mentioned that we should know, while it's undocumented, we get to find out something about the septic system as it is now. I think also that the planned backup is the town sewer, but it just some statement saying that that's a possibility, that there's nothing in the way, ledge outcroppings or whatever, that would make that less than feasible.
Excuse me.
Certainly.
Tim, are we getting, I want to be clear that I understand what you're asking. You want to know more about what the present or the prior use was as a three-bedroom residence, what items were there using water, generating waste, and what plan we
You described the difference in usage with regard to water, but not with regard to waste in your presentation. The review checklist says that you don't, that there is no additional expanded use of septic that is anticipated.
Mm-hmm.
So I need to know a little bit, I need to have some explanation from you or somebody as to, you know, how many people are going to be using this facility, how many people do you expect to be using this facility when it's completed, and how many people are using it now, and why that does not increase the septic flow into the system.
We can provide you that.
Yeah, we'll prepare calculations of the previous past, documenting it, presenting it to you.
Yep, we can do that.
Mr. Chairman, I just need to clarify then what issues there are that we still have outstanding tonight. If I could just summarize what the town planner just recently went through, I understand that there's now no longer an issue with respect to 5C, which is the location of easements, because you have that information. Is there still an issue with respect to 6D, the proposed parking areas, or has the applicant agreed to submit that at a later date?
Unless I'm mistaken, I believe the applicant has no problem with submitting additional information regarding the parking area. Okay.
Okay. Then perhaps I should address my next things to the applicant. There still, as I understand it, is an issue with respect to item number 10, which is parking, loading, and unloading area locations. You're requesting no further traffic analysis. The recommendation from the town engineer is that we do have traffic analysis, so we need to address that issue. I understand that there's only, well, then with respect to 12A, there's the outstanding issue of whether or not we want to require anything further with respect to the 5% increase. There is, as I understand it, we can determine based on the information before us that there's no longer an issue with respect to 12B, but that's still an outstanding issue at this point.
I believe the comments from Mr. Eichenberg relates to 12B and his request for additional information on capacity.
I'd like to go back to 12A because I'm not quite sure, Jan, how we left that. And I guess we're looking for consensus of the board here.
Mm-hmm.
That we are looking for more detail. Is that correct on the stormwater?
Yes, especially the town engineer has requested that there be additional information submitted on how this 5% increase will impact areas downstream.
Okay, some downstream. There was also a comment to an abutter's property, some ponding, and I didn't see where that was resolved in the material that we had. And I realize that borders on.
Yeah, I'd like, you know, could Mike,
certainly.
The engineer, talk to him?
Mike, do a comment. I'd like to just go over quickly the stormwater, and then we would like to get together with the town engineer and provide a little more information, but maybe I can explain what we have here and what we would like to do, and then see how the board feels
Thank
about
you.
That. Really, we've got, quickly, we've got two watersheds. One of them is right around here, the town hall parking lot, and it's pretty much what you see, the town hall. The other watershed is the road, the project site, and that goes back up to Casco Bank and the Murray property and the service station right here. It's actually a fairly large watershed. Eventually, they both outlet to the same place. In the town hall parking lot, you have a couple of catch basins over here and here, and they've sunk down pretty good. Some have maybe even driven over them. That takes this area over in here, around what we see here, the town hall, and it directs it out this way. I followed that culvert out, and it just really goes into just a big bowl. It's really impounds the water in there. It looked like eventually if it built up, it would outlet, and it would outlet and start to go down this way, which is going out back here. Back in the parking lot where we propose some additional parking, right now, you see some grass out there, but underneath that grass is a lot of gravel. You can tell that there was pavement out there at one time. It's something, and I understand there's actually a tennis court out there at one time. So the increase by paving what's out there now is going to be very slight, because actually we had some pavement out there at one time. So that's going to be fairly slight in that area there. That outlets straight out back, overland flow. Eventually we'll hook up with what comes out this side here. The large watershed in here is about 3.5 acres, and it's actually fairly large. I was very surprised when we did the calculations, and you know, you get a fair amount of flow that comes out into the back area here, which is just the other side of the barn, and then starts heading out back. There's a wet area there, and there's a a drainage, and you can see there's an outlet in there, it's fairly defined where that is going out. It takes water from Route 77, actually comes down the driveway to the filling station, works its way around. A little bit of water from Shore Road comes over and it goes all the way over, so it's a fairly significant area. What we're adding to that is really just the drive that's coming up through, so that's grass right now, we're going to be paving, so that would be the increase to that watershed. That watershed, as I say, goes out back, it goes in behind the property that we're going to be developing, which is in behind the parking area here. That's fairly ill-defined. It goes through some bushes and trees, and it's kind of hummocky. It rises up and down. You can see some wet areas of water can pond, gradually build up and goes out. And I tracked that down, and it looked like eventually this area would also hook up with it. It went down to an area which you say it was getting fairly close to look like the Rand property. Now, it might even be a little bit beyond the Rand property. At the time I looked at it, which is about a month ago, it's about a 20 by 50 area, which I call the pond. It's actually watering it. I went out tonight before I came in, and it's all dried up right now. So it's a big area, about 20 by 50, that's pretty wet in the bottom. So it looks like that builds up maybe about a foot, then outlets. That was a defined outlet from that low area, so I tracked that down. And then that started winding down. It looked like it was on to back out this way towards the Davis property. It reached into a very large, wet area. Fairly long, it was at least a couple hundred feet long, it was 20 to 40 feet wide in the areas, and the water was just sitting in there and didn't look like it was going anywhere. So at that point I felt that any increase would just kind of sit in there in the swampy area would act like a natural detention basin. We could go out and we could do the calculations of that. We've done the calculations to size the culvert in this area here. We could do the calculations to size what the increase would be and what the impact would be. I think one of the things with that is that it required a heck of a lot of survey work. What you have to do is actually survey all of that wet area, see how much storage capacity it had in there. It also required probably another $3,000 for an engineering study of the detention area and how that acts as you model that as it rises up and down. Survey might be another couple of thousand. So that was about $5,000 to do what we felt from inspection looking at it really wouldn't be a significant impact. So I think what we'd like to do would be to, you know, have the town engineer and walk them out through, maybe talk to some of the homeowners that is going out behind in the wooded area. If Maureen wanted to come out, any members of the planning board, maybe just take a walk down through and have them take a look at it, see if they were reasonably satisfied that it wasn't going to, you know, impact anything before we, you know, launched into a very expensive study. Providing on-site detention is really limited places you can provide it. I think that the only area would be probably somewhere in here, which is a nice green space and some trees and things like that. You're going to end up having a pond. And with that slight increase, I mean, it's very questionable how they work. I mean, you have to put a very small orifice in that, which has potential of getting clogged up. So we felt that the construction and of that, well, compared to the slight increase, if we could look at it and talk to some of the people, we just really felt that more by inspection and having two or three people look at it, and if they were all comfortable in addition to the neighbors, we felt that that would be a reasonable alternative to going and making an extensive engineering study in the area.
Thank you.
Excuse me, let me just ask, have you made any attempt to get in touch with the neighbors to see?
At this time, we haven't done anything. It was just really preliminary as with the ordinance. We just wanted to at least see what the board had to say and how well we feel about that in addition to the town people.
Thank you.
Mrs. McKay, I have spoken to Dr. and Mrs. Rand. They have yet a night if they wish to speak. They have the abutter.
I noticed their presence and didn't know. The Rand's interested in speaking?
Yes, I'm Pete Rand. Alice and I are the immediate abutters of this property, and I guess I would like to start out by saying that we're very pleased by this proposal for a couple of reasons. One is that we retain a residence next door. It will not change from its present character. Someone might have purchased this land and done something else with it, and so we still have a residential setting there, which is good. And number two, and I think most importantly, is that this buffer will remain between us and the home. The road that is being planned is coming out to the west rather than to the east, and therefore coming close to our property. So The buffer that remains essentially from a business zone, from residential zone, has not been disturbed by this proposal. I have some items to talk about. They're not really issues. I don't think that we have a very great concern. Perhaps the greatest concern would be with the, not with the lighting that is proposed, but we hope that it might be reflected or occluded in some way from the east, so that these high-pressure lamps that are going to be out here, which of course are necessary and should be there, but have something behind them so that they won't glare out to the east onto our property.
Excuse me, Mr. Rand. Most of these issues, we are still dealing with the completeness issue, and I appreciate the comments, but I think the appropriate place for the comments are the, if we have a public hearing,
okay,
to bring them up at that point.
Okay.
I appreciate that.
Then I would then respond properly to the issue about wetland, about the drainage.
What
my comments about that?
Leave it up to the other board members. This is not a public hearing, and we typically don't ask members of the public to come forward
okay,
other than a public hearing time.
I would like to hear from Dr. Rand about the stormwater, because I think we're trying to make a decision about whether or not we have concern from abutters and how stringently to
Based on that issue, if you just make a brief
If you go back comment. In the woods here, you'll find that there's some leaf litter that shows a little area where, during the most recent thunderstorm, perhaps we had last week, the leaves have been spread apart a little bit. There is no established drainage pattern down there. What we're talking about here, I think, perhaps is more the speed of the water going off than the volume of the water going off, and I don't know whether that's going to really impact on us importantly or not. I always didn't want a stream on my farm. I thought it'd be nice. But I don't think that we are overly concerned with that, but would like to see as much deflection as possible there.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Mr. McGovern, as applicant.
Thank you. Representing the applicant, I would like to speak for just a minute on whether or not a traffic study might be required. The planning board has, in the last several months, received a traffic study of the intersection that is most affected by this plan, and that was paid for by the town as a result of the Public Works project. In addition, a traffic study was done this past year by the Portland Area Comprehensive Transit Study, and as you probably read in the Cape Courier, the state has funded, subject to town council approval, a traffic light at that particular intersection. Third, the planning board received traffic study, I believe, when the first Atlantic proposal was reviewed last year, the housing for the elderly down on Scott Dyer Road. At the same time, the planning board received a study on the Viking proposal for the proposed addition to the Viking nursing home. I really can't, you know, see spending additional municipal resources during very lean economic times to have an additional study done of an intersection which is already overstudied. I understand that there may be some concern about what would happen if people cut through this lot, and I think we all agree there may be a little bit of that, although, you know, I think the way this meanders, there really is an incentive to do it. Beyond that, you know, obviously the folks who come to the town hall and to the community center from the Shore Road side are going to be coming in this driveway. Those of you that live on that end of town are probably going to be exiting that way rather than coming around this way. I'm not too sure we need a traffic study to figure that out. I think it's mostly common sense, but I would hope and would that the board would refer to its earlier studies instead of requesting a new study. Thank you.
Thank you. I guess for the board, it's a matter of how much of the technical merit can you make a decision on. My only comment was looking at an increased parking of 51 sites. Is there a lack of parking now, or is the additional 50 sites, and I don't want to get into technical merit, but is the request for 50 additional sites because of an overload here that now will over flow out through another access street.
Yeah, the request for the 22 parking sites are for the 1226 Shore Road property. The request for the additional town hall lots are because of an existing problem we have here on many evenings with parking, not only in terms of the number of spaces, but also in unsafe areas that folks are parking. The area just on the other side of this wall, some of you may have noticed trying to back up there at times. It's very tight, and what we're proposing to do is to crosshatch just outside the building to eliminate parking right against the building to serve as a fire lane.
I guess this crosses over with Tim Eichenberg's question about the use of the subject site. The 22 proposed, is that simply because that there's that much space available, or is it some type of, based on some type of use?
It's primarily, first, because of the space available, no question. And the thinking that we could have accommodated it back on this town hall lot, but we wanted, particularly for the elderly, to have parking up closer to the building so they wouldn't have to, they would be able to see the building when they get out of their car, so they wouldn't feel unsafe walking that distance. I'm not sure I answered your question.
Sort of. Sort of to neither. Thank you.
I don't need to answer it further?
No, that's fine. Okay. Because I don't want to get into a full discussion of that this time. I just want to get some indication. I think what I'm looking for right now is as we go and back up perhaps to number 10, I'm looking for a consensus from the board. Does the board feel that we need additional traffic study at this time to make a proper decision?
For completeness.
Right, in other words.
I don't.
Tim?
No.
It doesn't have to be unanimous.
Yeah, believe me, I don't have much difficulty if I feel strongly. I don't know when we have waived traffic requirements in the past, and since none of us have terribly long memories on the planning board, it does not trouble me unduly not to request a traffic analysis. I do want to say that it's a difficult thing to try to treat the town just like any other applicant. On the one hand, I don't want to defer unduly to the applicant because it is the town. On the other hand, we're all aware of the economic times that we're in. I suppose that I could see myself waiving traffic analysis for an applicant that was not the town under these circumstances, so I would have no difficulty waiving the traffic requirement for the town.
I'd concur that. I have more concerns about the flow of traffic on the site itself, not the increased traffic load to intersections and so forth. I'm concerned, and I'm not, again, that goes into technical merit. I'm concerned about that, but I don't think a traffic study is going to solve any of those issues. Okay, so we will. Going on to 12A, the need for stormwater system. Board members, would they like to see more study?
With respect to whether we want to see more, first off, I'd say I'd like to visit the site as a board. I would also like to visit the drainage area. I have no problem, though, right now saying for completeness I wouldn't not vote on this tonight. It's hard, though, to say when you don't have the material in front of you whether you need it or not.
My concern in this area is that the applicant is suggesting that the town engineer and planning board members and whoever else go and walk the site. That's fine, and I'd be very interested in walking it, but in terms of being able to decide whether, based on my observation, we're going to need more stormwater information, I don't expect to be able to come to a reasoned decision at the end. And I suspect what I would actually want to do in this situation is to defer to the town engineer. If the town engineer really finds that there's a need for additional information, then I would certainly go along with that recommendation.
See, I concur with that.
Tim? Judy? So at this point, if the town engineer requests further, we will ask that we receive more. 12B, C, and D. We've asked, Tim has asked, and I've concurred with him, more study. I think it's essential for the location and whatever information we can discover from the design, tied in with the proposed use. I'd like to see just at least some detail as to how feasible it is to hook up to the town sewer system as a backup system. Any other comments on that?
Just in the sense that for those three items, we have an outright no that they are not complete. And in a project of this nature where we are dealing with existing buildings and while in a change in use, it's probably not a major change, how often is a requirement like this kind of pushed off saying it isn't really needed at this point, and yes, we can vote it complete?
Maureen?
Well, one of the reasons I think that it's an outright no is because it's such a specific request for information. When you have a request for proposed parking areas, it's hard to not at least provide some parking area information. You know, either you show the sanitary system or you don't. As the town planner, I'm not concerned that we will not get that information in a subsequent submission by the applicant. Speaking with the applicant, they're planning on submitting that, and it would be pretty easy to see if it was not submitted, because again, it's very basic. Either it's there or it isn't.
Under the site plan ordinance, we do have the authority to waive these requirements and call an application complete without them.
I wouldn't waive it. You may want to designate it as a complete item with the understanding that additional information will be submitted, or that the applicant has agreed to submit additional information and condition your completeness upon that.
Mr. Chairman, I'm maybe on the other side of something that I was on the preliminary side of earlier. It seems to me, based on what we've done and going through the checklist so far, that there are a number of items that still need to be submitted, and perhaps the thing to do would be to table the motion for completeness until we've got everything before us, and then we can decide whether or not the thing is complete. I understood that we would go through the checklist tonight in order to determine the board's wishes with respect to certain items that were perhaps in question, and I think that we have done that at this point, although
I think what we're trying to do, whether we table it or do it, just simply say it's incomplete as of tonight, and the applicant needs to take note of what we consider to be complete, and that's our list. You know, we don't change our mind again in another month, and it's worthwhile to get a consensus on the board what we're looking for. There seem to be some minor items that simply are not complete. Do I get a consensus that we're looking for the sanitary disposal design and more identification? Okay. And I think it's lastly, the location design methods of solid waste, potable water, that's already been requested, is my understanding.
That's coming in later,
right.
So is 12D.
And 12D is as well. Is that right, Maureen?
Yes. Yes,
okay.
It is.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I'd like to make another comment about the traffic analysis. A couple of board members have indicated that they don't feel a need to reanalyze the intersection. I think it is reasonable to request that someone sit down and that the ITE manual, though, and work up the additional traffic figures for this use, certainly not distribute them which way they're going to turn and so forth. I'm not looking for that, but I would like to know. And I would have said, but you addressed it, Mike, that I'm concerned about the cut-through, but I don't think anyone can say who's going to cut through and when and if that's a problem. But it would be nice to know the additional traffic generated by this.
Mm-hmm. We will do that, but it's going to be difficult because some of it's going to be a displacement from one building to another, from this building over to that.
Now, I certainly, as a board member, I'm not looking for a traffic engineer to do this. I've done this with the manual myself, just to give us an idea of what the change might be.
I think that's a good suggestion. Is it clear to the applicant the review? Yes, Mr. Tarian.
Yes,
procedural question.
Certainly.
My understanding that when we return in the month, you will examine our application for completeness. And at that time, will it be possible to proceed in the next step of the process, or would that have to be deferred for another month?
No. Marie can correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't believe that requires another month.
It depends on whether the board wants to schedule a public hearing. Typically, there's no requirement in the ordinance that a public hearing has to be scheduled for site plans. If a public hearing is scheduled, typically the board will make a motion for completeness and then schedule a public hearing for the following month, and then other than some discussion to assist the applicant in making revisions to the plan, there's usually no more substantive review of a project until after a public hearing.
Is, other than, trying to think, as far as notice, public notice for a public hearing, would that preclude having a public hearing in 1 month as well?
No, you could schedule a public, I think you could schedule a public hearing, let me check the ordinance, but in terms of noticing this, scheduling it now would certainly, there would certainly be enough time for noticing it for next month.
I guess, first of all, we need to know is the wishes of the board to have a public hearing on this application.
I think it would be a good idea.
Yes, I do too.
Seems to be a consensus. So I would suggest if we can return this item to the agenda next month for completeness, and if possible, schedule a public hearing.
Is there any reason why we couldn't?
She's just checking the ordinance now.
I see nothing in here that precludes you scheduling a public hearing.
Before completeness is voted.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Is there any, if there's no more discussion, I think I'm looking for a motion. You made?
Mr. Chairman.
One quick question.
Yes.
Tonight is not the night for comments.
We're looking at completeness, not okay. Technical merit. In other words, technical issues about the application now.
I'll save it then.
Okay. Ms. McKay.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we schedule a public hearing on the town's application for 1226 Shore Road for the regular meeting in July, and we defer further consideration of completeness until that date.
Are you asking to table?
No.
In your motion, or?
I thought we were just deferring completeness and scheduling a public hearing.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? I guess that I would only ask the person making the motion that we just add the phrase, be it ordered at the beginning, to the motion.
I beg your pardon, I wasn't on the right page, but I certainly accept the amendment to the motion.
And the second, who made the second?
Both of us.
It's acceptable to you, thank you. No other discussion? All those in favor of the motion as stated, please raise your right hand. Opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you. See you next month.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, I guess we have two planning board members returning. One departing. On a new business, Fleet Bank sign permit request by Fleet Bank for wall sign ordinance, section 21-2-3. Before we begin, I'm an officer of Fleet Bank of Maine. I don't work for the operating bank. I do work for a subsidiary thereof, but there probably would be at least an appearance of a conflict of interest or bias. I will turn the chair over to Judy Kane. Judith Kane, sorry.
Do we have someone here from Fleet Bank?
come up. Would you come up and introduce yourself?
My name is Paul Liberty. I'm with Properties Management for Fleet Bank. I'm here this evening to request permission to install a wall sign at the Pond Cove Shopping Center.
And you're also going to put another sign on the directory, is that right?
That's correct.
So there are two signs.
The sign that we are proposing and has been designed by MuCraft is in accordance with the ordinance where we are staying beneath the 40 square feet that is allowed. The sign will be individually lit letters, and as you can see, if you have your on your poster there, that it's well in proportion to the storefront.
Do we have any comments from the board?
Mr. Liberty, how do you propose to light the sign, and what color will the lighting be?
I believe that the sign will be lit. It's an electric sign, and it'll be with white letters.
How late do you think it will remain lit?
That I don't know. Vince, have you discussed that?
I'm Vince Lobozo from the MuCraft Signs.
Mm-hmm.
What was the question?
Do you
how
want
long
to come
will
up?
The sign remain lit?
How long will it be lit?
Yeah.
No.
We may be, we usually have our signs either on an electric eye, which will be from dusk to dawn, or we could install a timer at which point we could set whichever time you feel that it could be shut off.
Was the prior sign, it was a backlit sign?
Yes.
The structure of this sign is exactly like what we're taking down.
I presumed so much.
The letters are going to be blue by the way. Oh.
Sorry.
It went from green to blue.
Green to blue, right.
Right.
White to blue.
If this weren't at the risk of sounding like a pun, such a blazing issue, because we've just done this sign ordinance, all these questions wouldn't be jumping into our minds, but we spent a lot of time on this backlit sign issue and how long they were going to remain lit, and so here's our first application, which is as straightforward as it could possibly be. It's almost too simple to even be here, and we're all just ready to tear you apart. So there is an issue for me. I'm just out of no more than curiosity. I don't remember what the other sign was, how long it was lit at night. Mm-hmm. Neither does anyone else. I mean, this again is probably a thing we all thought about but never noticed.
I do know that at various branches, like I say, we have different methods. Some branches will be a high exposure area where we have a electric eye where the sign will be lit 20, you know, from dusk to dawn. Other areas where it's not so visible, we take a more energy conservation approach and we shut the lights off like at midnight, 1 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure exactly what the Pond Cove Shopping Center has, if they do have any requirements as far as
well, in fairness, lights. I think you should keep your light on as long as Casco Banks does. How's that? We just dealt with a new sign for them, as I remember, just with them when they did their new little parking area, right? Did we address this? I don't remember.
I couldn't answer that question.
Oh.
Before your time.
Yeah. Do they have a shut-off time for their light at night? Or is it
I don't think they turn it off.
I guess it has been the practice of this board in the past to establish times where lights have to be turned off. There's nothing in the sign ordinance that says you can't do that. There is a standard that lighting has to be an appropriate level in keeping with the character of the area. So there are signs in town that are turned off at certain periods, but I don't think there's a uniform standard throughout town of when a sign has to go out or when lights go out.
The comment I recall from the Casco Bank meeting was that since nobody remembered when it was turned off, then it wasn't an issue.
I think the
flip side of that is that people in Cape Elizabeth go to bed at 10 o'clock anyway, so it doesn't matter after 10 o'clock because of the long drive back to Portland in the morning. I really don't know if that's a purview of the planning board to set up the scheduling of illumination of signs in the town center. One versus another would be nice if the merchants got together and came to some sort of an agreement and made a proposal to the board. I would arbitrarily say 11 o'clock is certainly late enough. If you haven't got the banking business accomplished by 11 at night, then perhaps you can wait until the next day. And it's also a good energy conservation measure. I agree with the chairperson in that this is a very small application and it almost seems unnecessary to be before the board, but congratulations on being the first ones here. I have no objections to what I see. The only concern I would have is if it were a brilliant blue that actually cast some signs are extremely, the backlit signs can be extremely bright and almost cast a blue color across with a neon illumination inside. I don't perceive that being an issue. Do you have any idea at all the foot candles or the brightness of the illumination?
Well, you asked me that earlier. I have no idea. But blue is hard to light, so it's, yeah. You've got the opposite problem where it's hard to get it bright enough so that you can discern the color style. There are sets already installed in Scarborough and Saco, so.
I don't have any problem with what I see here at all.
I concur with Mr. Emery's statements.
So presuming that we will leave nothing more or say more about the times of illumination, which I just wish I had never mentioned, perhaps, do we have any kind of a motion? I need to appoint an associate. I'm new at this. Forgive me. Either one. How about Tim Parkhurst? I appoint Mr. Parkhurst.
Mr. Eichenberg.
Eichenberg, close. Oh. This is not for me. I like sitting over there where my chair has all my answers. Accept my apology and please vote on this. Now, do we have a motion?
It's going to be a tough one. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and material submitted and the facts presented, the request of Fleet Bank for a wall sign at the Branch Bank in Pond Cove Shopping Center is granted pursuant to Section 21-2-3A of the Sign Ordinance.
Second.
All those in favor, raise your right hands. Opposed? It's passed.
Thank you very much.
Sign up. Do we get sleep there? I do. That's it. That's the journey. Okay, I'll ask if anybody else has anything else to say. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Mm-hmm.
Favor? A second? Favor? Opposed? So moved, we are adjourned.